Hey, welcome back to the Bible Challenge. This is session 3. It's really the one I've been waiting for, so I can't wait to dig into it with you. But first, a little bit of Bible trivia just for fun, okay? I'm going to read you some questions, give you a chance to think about them. We're going to talk about the answers at the end of this video. So here's the first question. How many books in the Old Testament of the Bible? Ah, that's a good one. Second question, how many books in the New Testament of the Bible? Think about these for a second. First question, how many books in the Old Testament? How many books, secondly, in the New Testament? All right. Okay. Third question, what type of insect did John the Baptist eat in the wilderness? Gross, right? But that really happened. And we're going to see what the answer is. The fourth question is this, who asked Pilate for Jesus's body after the crucifixion? All right. And number 5, what's the shortest book in the New Testament? Shortest New Testament book. Number 6, to what city was Saul traveling when he encountered the blinding light? Some of you might remember this story. I'll give you a hint, it's in the book of Acts. But yeah, that's number 6. Where was Saul going when he encountered the blinding light? Number 7, which gospel is written by a doctor? Some of you probably know that one. A lot of you probably know that one. And number 8, in the Gospel of Mark, how does the Virgin Mary learn of her pregnancy? All right, so those are the 8 trivia questions just for fun to start this session off. Once again, thanks for joining me. This is session 3. We're going to talk about why you can trust the Bible. Such an important topic. Again, I've been wanting to dig into this with you. Just a quick preview. So coming next, in session 4, we'll talk about how the Bible is organized. Session 5, the uniqueness of the Bible. Session 6, making the Bible part of your daily life. And session 7, really going to need this one. This is the tools that you need. Simple, easy, accessible tools that will make the Bible just come alive to you. That I want to share with you things that have changed my life. So let's dive into this session on why you can trust the Bible. I want to give you 3 reasons why you can trust the Bible. The first one is prophetic evidence. There's a lot of Old Testament prophecies that came true, and we want to look at those because if a prophecy comes true and it's big, it's a reason to trust the Bible. And if what the Bible says in its words that relate to you come true, that's a big deal. So we want to look at how it's performed in the past, honestly. So what we find is this. I'm going to read you some stuff that I think will be very helpful to you. Number 1, sometime before 500 BC, the original prophet Daniel proclaimed that Israel's long-awaited Messiah would begin his public ministry at 483 years after the issuing of a decree to restore and rebuild Jerusalem from Daniel chapter 9, verses 25 and 26. He further predicted, listen to this, that the Messiah would be cut off, killed, and that this event would take place prior to a second destruction of Jerusalem. Abundant documentation shows that these prophecies were perfectly fulfilled in the life and crucifixion of Jesus. The decree regarding the restoration of Jerusalem was issued by Persia's king Artaxerxes to the Hebrew priest Ezra in 458 BC. So listen to this. This prophecy was that the Messiah was going to come 483 years after this decree, and that decree was in 458 BC. 483 years later, the ministry of Jesus Christ began in Galilee. I'm just saying, 483 years. Again, this happened in 458 BC by the prophet Daniel. 483 years later, Jesus begins his public ministry. Remember that due to calendar changes, the date for the start of Christ's ministry is set by most historians in about AD 26. Again, it was the move from the Julian to the Roman calendar. And also note that from 1 BC to 1 AD is just 1 year. So that's why these things line up. Jesus' crucifixion occurred only a few years later, and about 4 decades later in AD 70 came the destruction of Jerusalem by the Roman Emperor Titus. Now, I know that was a lot of words and a lot of stats and a lot of details, but I hope that at least it serves for, 1, you can go back and replay this, 2, do your own research on this. This is such an important topic. You can go to reasons.org. What an incredible resource. And find out, like, how has the Bible performed in the past? Because sometimes if we're ignorant of that, we just assume that certain people's criticisms might be true. Well, in this case, we can see this prophecy came absolutely true. Second piece a prophetic evidence I want to share with you, and there's a ton. I'm just sharing three quick ones with you. In approximately 700 BC, the prophet Micah named the tiny village of Bethlehem as the birthplace of Israel's Messiah in Micah chapter 5, verse 2. The fulfillment of this prophecy and the birth of Christ is one of the most widely known and widely celebrated facts in history. That's amazing. Again, the chances of these things just randomly happening is actually 1 in 10 to the fifth power. And so it's a big deal. Number three, in the 5th century BC, a prophet named Zechariah declared that the Messiah would be betrayed for the price of a slave, 30 pieces of silver, according to Jewish law, and also that this money be used to buy a burial ground for Jerusalem's poor foreigners, Zechariah 11, 12 to 13. Now, Bible writers and secular historians both record 30 pieces of silver as a sum paid to Judas Iscariot for betraying Jesus, and they indicate that the money went to purchase, what? A potter's field, just as predicted, used for the burial of poor aliens, Matthew 27, 3 to 10. Again, just these aren't random fulfillments of prophecy. These are God-ordained, God-breathed words that came that had power and accuracy. And because those things have been fulfilled, as have many, many, many more, we can trust the Bible. Here's a second reason. Let's look at it. Okay, let's talk about the second reason why we can trust the Bible, the second piece of evidence. But before we do that, I want to talk about why this matters. Remember when you were a kid and you played the telephone game? You know, there's this big circle of people, and one person on one end started out with a statement and said to the next person, you know, the brown car races past the red bicycle. And the next person heard something kind of close. It was like the brown car whooshes past the red bicycle. So they say that to the second person. And the third person hears this. The brown car swishes past the blue bicycle. And all of a sudden, it starts to change over time, right? And so this is people's fear with the Bible. And yet it's also kind of the hearsay, the gossip that goes around. Because if we don't know what the first person said, we got to go back to that. That's why we're going back to things that haven't changed. So I want to talk about the second big reason why we can trust the Bible is archaeological evidence. Archaeological evidence is fantastic and absolutely amazing reason why we can trust the Bible. In other words, stuff that the Bible talks about, places and things and events, have been substantiated in archaeological findings. People who've gone back and done these digs, you know, in these ancient cities, and they've found the exact kinds of things and the exact events, some of the exact places and descriptions that the Bible talks about. So I'm going to give you just one. Okay, there's so many of these. I'm going to give you a place where you can go find more. But there was this Battle of Lachish that happened. And I want to describe it to you and show you some pictures. I think this is going to blow your mind like it blows mine. But within the palace of King Sennacherib at ancient Nineveh, located within the modern day territory of Iraq, Layard found a series of wall reliefs. These snapshot images portray one of the most famous biblical battles and great military conquests of King Sennacherib. The 40-inch wide by 17-inch high relief called the Siege of Lachish relief is now on display at the British Museum. It portrays the famous Assyrian king's attacks on the biblical city of Lachish. This extra-biblical source, that just means outside the Bible, portraying in detailed imagery the same account mentioned in the Bible, not only validates the biblical narrative, but adds great detail to the biblical account. The relief depicts the Lachish fortress, siege weapons, Assyrian troops, and Jewish captives being led away from the city. Now, in 2 Kings, in the Bible, chapter 18, verses 13 and 14, it says this. It says, in the 14th year of King Hezekiah's reign, King Sennacherib of Assyria came to attack the fortified towns of Judah and conquered them. King Hezekiah sent this message to the king of Assyria at Lachish. I have done wrong. I will pay whatever tribute money you demand, if only you will withdraw. This is the King Sennacherib coming to attack the town Lachish, and it had been done. And now King Hezekiah of Judah goes, hey, I got to tell this guy to back up before he gets to my town. That's what happened. And there's a link that you can go see. I'll put that right here on the video. And you can check out more about what this is all about. But archaeologist Nelson Gleck's declaration that no archaeological discovery has ever controverted a biblical reference still stands. That's amazing. Listen to that again. No archaeological discovery has ever controverted a biblical reference. In other words, nothing that's ever been found in archaeology has ever contested or disproved a biblical reference. Is that not amazing? And yet instead, there's tons of these things that have substantiated what the Bible already claims. I think that's really important. A book that you should read if you're interested in this is Evidence That Demands a Verdict by Josh McDowell. So those things, to me, have been some of the most faith-building, trust-building pieces, the archaeological evidence for the trustworthiness of the Bible. Okay, ready for number three. This one is probably my favorite. I know I probably keep saying this is my favorite, but this one's my favorite. The manuscript evidence for the Bible is unbelievable. In other words, the documentation, the reliability, the historicity, the way that we have gotten our Old Testament and New Testament is hands down the most reliable source of literature in history. And I want to show you some stuff that absolutely is amazing. There's a comparison chart that you can find at the CARM website, Christian Apologetics and Research Ministry, and it shows kind of a comparison. And this is, I think, what matters when you look at historical documents, because a lot of times you'd go like, well, is it true that Julius Caesar was a Roman emperor? Well, yeah, I mean, nobody would contest that. Well, how do we know? Well, because of, you know, historians like Pliny, or even Lucretius, or even Plato. I mean, Plato would be older than that, but if you were to ask, were the Greeks ever a real civilization? I mean, how do we know? It's 2000 AD, 2020, and, you know, this is way, way back when. How do we know that? Well, it'd be historians like Herodotus, you know, that would substantiate those claims. And so I want to just kind of do a little comparison of literature because, as an example, Plato was written, he wrote his stuff around 427 to 347 BC, okay? And the earliest copy we have of anything Plato wrote is from 900 AD. That's a 1,200 year gap. Okay, well, these things are old and, you know, it's hard to keep them around, right? But the number of copies we have of Plato's original writings like that would be 7 copies, okay? So we're basing our assumptions about history. Actually, we don't even call them assumptions. We call them historical facts, undisputable. Because why? Because Plato said it. And we have 7 copies of what he said, although there is a gap of 1,200 years between what he said and the earliest copy we have of what he said. Remember that telephone game? That's a long time. Things could have changed, right? Herodotus, 480 to 425 BC, yet our earliest copy is 900 AD. Again, a 1,300-year gap. We have 8 copies of Herodotus. It's not that many copies, and it's a long time between when he wrote it and the earliest manuscript that we have available. But let's take a look at Caesar, okay, as an example, 100 to 44 BC, yet the earliest copies we have is 900 AD, that's a 1,000-year gap, we have 10 copies, all right? How about Aristotle? This gets a little bit better, it's 384 to 322 BC, and the earliest copies we have is 1,100, that's a 1,400-year gap, but we have 49 copies of Aristotle, so a little more kind of satisfying. Now, how about Homer with the Iliad and the Odyssey? Okay, the Iliad specifically was written around 900 BC. We have a copy from 400 BC, and so that's only a 500-year gap, and we have 643 copies of Homer. That's a lot better. And so then when you go, okay, well, how does that compare with the Bible? Well, here's how it compares to the Bible. The Bible was written between 50 and 90 AD, and the earliest copies we have are from the 2nd century AD, right about 130. That's less than a 100-year gap between when it was written and the earliest manuscript we have. And here's the kicker that makes this so compelling for me. We have 5,600 copies of manuscripts of the New Testament. It just, hands down, there is no other literature that is this reliable, this historically documentable, this consistent. And so you can look at that and go like, well, what the original writing was, we have within 100 years of that. And we have so many copies that they all agree that we could look at that and go, that is so reliable. There's another resource that I hope you can go get on Josh McDowell's website that I think is also really fantastic. But I'm excited about how God can use these things, the prophetic evidence, the archaeological evidence, the manuscript evidence, to really build our faith in the Bible. And before we wrap up, I got to share two things. One, of course, the trivia answers. But secondly, before that, I want to share what I think is even a more personal reason why I trust the Bible. And here's the reason why, is because it works. I mean, it works in my life. When I read in Psalm 119:105, your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. And then I read that verse when I need wisdom, and I realize that, oh man, all these other things that God has said already speak to the wisdom that I need. And so I'll go look up, and what do I do when I'm afraid? What do I do when I'm anxious? What do I do when I'm confused or guilty? What do I do when I'm angry? And God's word just works, you know? And so I would look at that and go like, you know what? It is the personal evidence to me that really changes my life more than anything else. I hope that that's meaningful to you. I want to give you now the answers to the trivia and then some homework, okay? So here's the answer to the 8 trivia questions that I asked you in the beginning. 1, how many books in the Old Testament? Anybody know? 39. 39 books in the Old Testament of the Bible. Okay, secondly, how many books in the New Testament? 27. 27 plus 39 is 66. That's how many books are in the Bible. Here's the third one. Some of you already probably guessed this one. What type of insect did John the Baptist eat in the wilderness? And it was a locust. Well, probably lots of locusts. And honey, if you remember the story, locusts and wild honey. 4, who asked Pilate for Jesus's body after the crucifixion? That was Joseph. Joseph specifically of Arimathea. He was the wealthy person that wanted to take care of Jesus' body and offered his tomb that Jesus could be buried in. Amazing. 5, what's the shortest book in the New Testament? This one was tricky because there's a few really, really short ones, but the shortest book in the New Testament is 2 John, the little letter of 2 John, the epistle. 6, to what city was Saul traveling when he encountered the blinding light? Well, it was Damascus. Yeah, not Damascus, Oregon, in case you're from the Portland area, but Damascus in Syria was the city he was headed to. 7, which gospel is written by a doctor? Well, it is Luke. The good doctor Luke wrote the Gospel of Luke. And last, in the Gospel of Mark, who tells the Virgin Mary about her pregnancy? Well, it was the angel Gabriel. That's how she found out, the announcement from the angel Gabriel, that she was pregnant with God's child. Now, here's a little homework for you as we get ready and get ready to move on to session 4, which is going to be about how the Bible is organized. But here's the homework, is think of a time when God's word became true to you and spend some time thanking him for it. Thanks so much for joining for this Bible challenge. I hope it's really strengthening your faith and your trust in God's word. And I hope that you're starting to assimilate more and more of it. We're going to get even more strategic and intentional about it in the sessions to come.